I'd like to talk a little bit and get your opinions on some of the new systems that we've come up with at the Institute. We have some new gases that are extremely cost-effective.
Well, I think I could point out a gas that we're just starting with. It's hair gas. So not very much is known about it, but when this gas is disseminated, it, within the course of 15 to 20 minutes, will grow hair all over any exposed area of the skin.
It impairs the vision greatly, I believe.
Not only does it impair the vision, but the sense of terror, anxiety, and complete dislocation.
I would think, this is Steiner again, that in middle-class communities where people wish to be clean-cut, this would have a devastating psychological effect also.
Not only that, but as the hair continues to grow, it weights the individual down to such a degree that it becomes far more difficult to move.
We went with it for a while. I mean, it's the effect on enemy morale was impressive. But the fact that it only slows them down and doesn't stop them meant that we abandoned that research pretty early.
Yes, however, we have now added some elements to this gas by which we can also produce dandruff, psoriasis, and ultimately baldness.
Look, may I speak as a consumer? This is Steiner again. You've got all this stuff. You need to try it out, and I'm left with a stick of dynamite half the time instead of some of the stuff, some of the great stuff you have. I get promised shipments. I call up 2 weeks. It's not here. I call up a month later. It's not here. And I'm still waiting.
Steiner, can you tell us something about the nature of your operations? What sort of things have you been up to lately?
Well, the other day I was walking down the street and this guy looked at me and he said, why don't you take a bath, you creep? And I found out where he lived later. I called up I told him to, that I had to quit fooling around with my daughter on the phone with my voice disguised.
See, I think...
And I said I was going to kill him.
Mr. Steiner,
then I said that I work at the cab company, and as soon as I got off my job, I was coming over there with a tire iron and going to break his head open.
Yes,
then,
if you become personally involved with your victims, you ultimately have lost the war.
Hey, let me finish my story.
Your actions.
Well, what happened?
Well, I called him up, then I called the cab company... And I said, hey, could you come over? And I sent him to this guy's house. And I said, do you got a tire iron or something? Because my grandma has her suitcase stuck in the closet. So he came on over. I was watching from the bushes. In the meantime, the guy in the house had called the cops, and it was very dark. And they all panicked, and they ended up, the cops beating the guy to death. That's kind of a new thing I've been doing.
Let's call it what it is. That sounds like murder.
Modern warfare has nothing to do with that. People like the colonel... And Dr. Behrens and myself are totally dispassionate as far as specifically putting somebody away.
Look, if you send me some decent technology, I can get out of this chicken stuff.
Oh, I don't believe so, Steiner.
I think it's your state of mind.
Let me just bring up a couple of systems that we're working on now. We're working on a new method of producing nuclear warfare called nuclear fashion, which the way it works is we have a warhead disguised as a mannequin. And what this does is it throws off the enemy's anti-missile missiles. They can't tell that it's a missile because the mannequin is all dressed up in the latest fashions.
I wonder how many people have spoken of the new brands of electrical warfare that we've been experimenting with. What you do, basically, in simple terms, is a small band of advanced troops invades one side of a country, and they plant on that end of it an incomplete electrical circuit. Then another band invades the other side of the country. They also, of course, have very simple wire set up, and all they have to do is connect the two wires, generate some electricity, and the entire area becomes completely electrified.
When you talk about electrical warfare, you're still dependent on foreign oil or foreign energy sources.
True.
And I think the ultimate solution to that is going to be that we're going to have to deal more in electromagnetic warfare, things like implanting metal objects on the enemy and then using a huge electromagnet to drag them into the sea.
You said nothing about the sterility bomb, of course, which is can be very effective. It makes the entire male population totally, completely sterile.
Well, we put the lid on that. We can't. Unborn casualties aren't casualties.
But they aren't yet. But
it's an abstraction.
It's only an abstraction until we learn how to extract it, as we say in the business.
But how can you publish how many children would have been born and claim those as actual casualties?
Well,
there is honesty and integrity in what we're doing.
It remains a secret.
It is published.
We just have to, well, it's published, but not to the general
quarterly.
Public.
Anyone who's read Conditional Quarterly can quote you many, many such figures as this.
Obvious to you how it works, and we offered it to the Russians for use in any possible war with the United States, and the government nixed it as part of the result of invasion of Afghanistan, and I'd like to know why. I think we've got a dandy weapon on our hands put in the hands of the enemy.
Let me fill you in on this story on this boomerang bomb.
All right, right on.
First of all, we found it impossible to test, and if it's not reliable, then it could become a very dangerous weapon to put in the hands of the enemy.
Well,
we have to know that it will boomerang, and we couldn't test it ourselves.
Gentlemen, could you spend a little time with the little terrorist? A person like me who's out, say, in upstate New York, has a job to do, and you're talking about massive weapon systems, things which really aren't very practical as far as I'm concerned.
Well, now, are you telling us that your work doesn't depend on results? I mean, contributions are your form of,
yes, but
of appropriation.
To the extent I have to have some kind of device in my hands, I have to have the technology in my hands. Otherwise, I'm back to razor blades, cyanide, you know, the whole old game.
I was hitchhiking from the West Coast to the East Coast, and in one of the Midwestern states, I was picked up by a hippie in a Land Rover. He had long hair, a cowboy hat, a handlebar mustache, and buckskin fringe all over him, and one of those little leather pouches at his belt that you could keep dope in. And he was wearing moccasins with jingle bells on them, so you could hear him coming. Ring-a-ling, ring-a-ling, ring-a-ling. We drove, constantly. He would drive, and then when he was tired, he would crawl back, kind of jingle back into the back seat of the Land Rover and sleep, and then I would drive. Well, about 4 a.m., we pulled into a truck stop that's on the Pennsylvania Turnpike, just before you get to a lot of tunnels cutting through the mountains. There were a lot of trucks outside this diner. We parked, got out of the car, and walked across the lot. And there was an awful silence when we came through the door, a silence in which you could very clearly hear my friend's footsteps jingling as he jingle, 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 walked over and ordered some coffee. The whole place was hostile. And my friend got into an ugly argument with one of the truck drivers there. a big, fat truck driver kind of a guy who began muttering things under his breath like, faggot, hippie faggot. And I was all for getting out of there extremely fast and going on. But my friend was a real ideological hippie, and he wanted to argue with this guy. He wanted to reason with him. And he began telling him things like he could understand that his sexuality was threatened, but there was really no reason for that, and why didn't he just relax and open up to reality? And the truck driver just kept saying, faggot, 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 in a louder and louder voice. My friend began to get into a kind of diatribe, somehow connecting the truck driver with the Vietnam War, explaining to him that his way of thinking was outmoded and outdated, that it was doomed, and that he belonged to a whole consciousness that was going to be wiped off the face of the earth. And he was saying, you know, paradise now, and it's your kind of people that are holding the whole human race back. And so I finally dragged him away with the truck driver really furious by this time. We took off really fast because I realized the truck driver had followed us out, and he had gotten into his truck right behind us. And he had one of those huge rigs, a huge truck with a huge trailer behind it. And I was annoyed with my hippie friend, but I was also annoyed at the truck driver who, as we came to the first tunnel on the pike, came barreling up right behind us inside this long tunnel and flashed on his high beam and sat on his horn. As soon as we got out of the tunnel, the truck driver sped up, passed us, swung around very fast, and cut in sharply so that his rig swung around behind him, sort of jackknifed behind him in a fast sweep. I slammed on the brakes, and the rig missed us by maybe an inch or two. And if it had hit us, it would have crushed us against the side of a cliff. Very thoroughly crushed us. I think he was trying to kill us. And then he took off very fast down the highway. Well, my hippie friend was furious. He made me pull over so he could get behind the wheel and catch up with the trucker. It turned out there were a lot of trucks, but very few cars driving on the pike at that hour. Our truck driver friend was going very fast. He was passing the other trucks, and then we would pass the other trucks. This happened for a couple of miles, but then I don't know if he was on the CB to the other trucks or if they just knew something was wrong, because it began to happen after he'd pass one of the trucks. That truck would move over into the middle of the highway and slow down so that we couldn't pass it. And my hippie friend was driving more and more recklessly, and he'd finally managed to slip past either on the right or the left side. He didn't much care which at this point. And it was a wild, insane chase scene. Incredibly exhausting. Well, after about an hour of this, I said, look, for goodness sake, let's stop. We're going to have a wreck. We're going to get killed. This is crazy. We hadn't succeeded in closing the distance between us and the truck at all. So finally, I was able to persuade him to let up. And we pulled into a truck stop, got out wearily. I was relieved. Thankful we were still alive. And we walked through the door. And everybody stopped talking and looked over at us. The only sound you could hear was my friend's jingle bells as we walked over to the counter. Ring-a-ling. Ring-a-ling. Ring-a-ling.
What about the new uniforms? I had just heard that there are some rather remarkably handsome uniforms that I suppose in order to draw people into the military, they have made the uniforms much more attractive.
These are our designer creation uniforms to match with the weapons.
We're also moving toward diversification in uniform. We're developing something which we call mufti, which is that essentially a soldier's dress will be indistinguishable from civilian dress, The result could be, in a state of emergency, instant conscription, because you would have an entire uniformed population.
Yes. Everybody brings out their gun, and we're ready to go.
Right, and I think that's something, because I think war can be a bond between men and women, and one of the things we're looking for is a way of achieving a kind of solidarity, a kind of unity, a kind of brotherhood, if you will. And I think that this, it's a positive trend.
I'd like to talk about a psychological experiment, psychological warfare I conducted. Had to do it without advanced technology, since I never get shipments from you guys. But what it consisted of, I stuck a speaker under my 5-year-old son's pillow. I had a microphone and an amplifier. And at night, I'd whisper to him, "Your mother's dead. Your mother's dead." She did pass away a few years ago. And I'd also whisper, "Your father doesn't really love you. Your father doesn't really love you." I'd do this for a half an hour to 45 minutes every night. I noticed my son would start clinging to me. I would, of course, withdraw. He'd come to me and cling, and I'd withdraw. I did this every night until last week he finally broke, screamed, rolled around the floor, urinated, lost most of his speech control apparatus. I was just thinking, if we projected this over a community, or perhaps over a country, it all it takes is the technology, we could do just about anything we wanted.
You're talking about an army of spies now. You're talking about half of your fighting force having to secretly infiltrate the country, become friendly with the enemy, plant these devices.
No. This can be done from a central location. You merely have to implant the speakers. You simply say that the father or the mother do not love them anymore. The mother or the father doesn't have to do it.
In other words, if you had not done the physical withdrawal from your son, you're saying it would have worked anyway. But
well, that heightens it. But I notice that if most kids come on strong to their parents, especially if they've been harassed with a long work day, will naturally tend to push away day after day.
You're talking about Cold War. I think that works in a frigid climate. But what do you do in the tropical countries where people cling to each other so
readily? I think when they talk about the Cold War, they talk about the way parents can be cold to their children. I think this is perhaps what he's talking about.
Yes,
the Cold War in the sense of chilly relationships between people.
That's right.
You know, you guys make me a little sick and tired with
Steiner, don't get defensive. Don't get us wrong.
I'm a little steamed, you know? We're all professionals. I give you a lot of respect.
We owe a great deal to you, Steiner.
You snipe at me.
The difference between you and the rest of us, Steiner, is that we are civil people. We are engaged in civil war, and you are engaged in uncivil war.
Look, you send me some shipments, then you don't send me anything at all. I try to do a job, the equipment doesn't arrive, so I do it the best I can. Now you guys are driving me nuts with
Steiner,
this.
Steiner, calm down. Just calm down. Don't get us wrong, because I think I can speak for all of us when I say that we have real admiration for what you do at the scale you do it on.
I'm glad you said that.
Well, I think it's something that needed to be said.
Okay, then admit it. When you open up your papers and you find that 8 or 9 people were killed in some mysterious blast, you get a little pleasure from it. You know you were connected to it, right? I'm not totally isolated, am I?
Steiner, frankly, I think you've just made the point that we've been trying to make. You're a man blaming on his shoes the faults of his feet, I think. The problem is not that you don't have the technology. It's you, Steiner.
Look, I'm out here working the best I can. You don't help me. You just carp at me. You criticize me.
You complain all the time. You say you're doing the best you can.
It's better than the best I can. It's great.
We refuse to believe.
I have no one to talk to. I have no one to tell me, hey, you did a great job. Hey, you killed 8. Hey, you killed 4. You maimed 16. I don't have anyone to talk to. I can't tell my wife. I can't tell my children. Well, my one child you can't even talk to now, which is okay. That's great.
Steiner, you are...
You really got me steamed up. I'm usually very calm. You know, but you are people in the industry, people I respect, you know, and I just don't expect this from you guys.
Operator?
Did anyone hear someone on the line?
Operator?
Hello, who is this?
Did you hear that?
Who is this? Who is this is the question.
Is that your wife, Dr. Blunt?
Hello, oh, is this area code?
I've never heard her voice before.
Is this 202-989-4304?
No, this is not. There's no number remotely like
well,
that.
Well, would you please hang up?
Are you authorized to be on this call?
What, is my phone being tapped?
Madam, you had no business listening in on this.
Are you guys playing with my head?
Are you at the bureau, lady?
Phone. I'm trying to get in touch with my cousin.
What is your name and address,
Chicago.
Please, lady?
Not funny.
What's your name and address?
And I have heard a lot of sick conversation on this phone.
Oh, just a minute, young lady. I wouldn't call what we're saying sick.
I mean, I've heard things about, for the past 30 minutes, you people have been talking about warfare and killing, and I wonder where are your heads?
Hey, I'm going to hang
up.
Not at
all, young lady.
We're making this. I don't care if it's
the likes of you, young lady. That's the word.
The likes of me?
This is serious.
I can hardly believe the stuff I've heard. You guys are lunatics.
How do you think?
Crazy lunatics.
Madam, do you think of yourself as a patriot?
I think of myself more as a matriot than a patriot.
We deal in what people
want. It should be understood. If you understand the nature of violence, then perhaps you can deal with it and solve it.
Violence is a very important good part of our culture, young lady. This is our culture. It represents our culture
before they do violence. You've been listening to Joe Frank. This program is a shorter version of the show called Warheads, featuring Mark Hammer, Arthur Miller, Paul Mantell, Lester Nafzger, Avery Hart, and Joe Frank. It was originally produced for NPR Playhouse in 1983. To listen to the entire show, go to joefrank.com.